did they think they needed? Obviously nothing. If they had a perceived need, we would be there. Why aren't we there? In part because of this heresy of Gnosticism that says our culture is not capable of reflecting the divine nature of God in us as well or as good as a European cultural expression. That ours is sinful and etc. And God is bringing reconciliation to that gap between native and white. And we got, you know, our part, folks, we got to release our bitterness and unforgiveness and resentment. And some of you have been in denominational wars, you know, with AG for the last 85 or so years. You fought your wars. And they fought their wars with the American Baptists and the Nazarene and the home missions. And we're the paternal, you know, we're the stepchild ministry of many denominations and parachurches. And so it's been a struggle for us, but God is bridging that gap in humanness so that we can let Jesus step into our boat. The challenge for us, my brothers and sisters, is can we allow the Lord to touch us deeply so that he can get into our boat? You know, the Reverend Billy Graham, you probably all have heard this quote before, but he said, the greatest moments of Native history may lie ahead of us if a great spiritual renewal and awakening should take place. The Native American has been a sleeping giant. He is awakening. The original Americans could become the evangelists who will help win America for Christ. Right. Then he said, remember this is the opportunity. I believe it. I want to be a part of it. Yes. I want to say, Jesus, if there's anything in my life that prohibits you from getting into my boat, Lord, I'm really open. Help me. And can we let Jesus get into our Indian boat, our Eskimo boat? You may not believe it, but culture is a very key component in what our contribution is going to be to the body of Christ. And with that, I'd like to invite Brother Lloyd to come up. And we're just going to open it up for some questions. If Lloyd has a couple of brief comments. I began at 6 minutes after. I've been now speaking for 35 minutes. I have 45. So I'm not a full blood, so the white part is really in tune.
I'm just not going to say much, except the Lord loves diversity. And just look at how many fish are in the sea. Look at how many different kinds of trees are on the earth. How many different mountain ranges and valleys and different kinds of fruits and vegetables. Look at the stars above. His glory is reflected in those different aspects. And they are very diverse and they're not all equal. They're not identical either. Somehow, we're not identical either, but we're equal. And with each different flavor and size and shape and cultures, the Lord's glory wants to fill us. And that we reflect as an awesome range of colors and flavors and heights and depths, we can taste the glory of God when we get to Him, because we're not all the same. Man, we're not the same. The Lord created diversity. The Lord loves diversity. And He loves our people, all people. And just be proud. Stand tall. Walk without shame because of what Jesus has done to you. Share that with others. We just want to open it up for questions, maybe some things that Richard has said, just whatever, that we might be able to address. We're not the answer givers, but we believe that God has given us some vision for our future, and that we want to serve and come alongside and help, and we need help too. And we were just, you know, this is, we want this short time to be a safe time for you. You're not around maybe some of your home folk, maybe some people who have different views. Maybe you've had questions about these things your whole life. And maybe that we can just make this a safe time where you can open up and maybe ask some things that you've been wanting to ask for a long time. So,
let me be real non-Indian and say that please try to ask questions, not make too much commentary, and to be really not if we would be okay, I have permission to interrupt you if you start going too long, and then we can repent and ask forgiveness later.
Thank you, brother, for sharing what is in our heart as a people. Thank you so much. I'm not standing only here for my husband and I, but I'm standing up here for our Native ministers. For so many years, we have seen our white ministers with finances coming from the States, enough to meet their needs. And we raise up our Native leaders, and we say, here's $200 a month, you live on that. As a Native person, I dread raising Native leaders, wanting them to live on poverty, wanting them to, knowing the struggles that they're going to go through. My question is, what can I do as a Native person to make other churches see that our Native people are just as important and just as in much financial need as these others? I don't want no offenses. I don't want no looking down. All I want is the eyes open that we need to raise Native leaders with financial backing. And Mike and I, it took us 3 years to finally get to a point. We've had to call Brother McKenzie and say, Brother McKenzie, we have no food in our house. We have no food, and he'll put $250 in, just no obligation. But I believe that if our white brethren knew what our plight was, that they would be more than happy. We have Native ministers here that have a need. God bless you for giving to them.
Among the Lakota people, we have a similar thing we call the memorial. We have one tricky part. When the person dies, the family of the deceased saves all these gifts, and then a year later, we have a giveaway. We give it to anybody that comes, we feed everybody, we give gifts. But in the old days, they believed that the spirit of the deceased, the Nahi, stayed around for 1 year, and at the end of that year, you would have one last meal. So they would take a plate of food off to the woods, and the Nahi would share his last meal or her last meal before it went away. They asked me to do a memorial for my auntie a couple years ago. The Nahi presented a big problem for me. How was I, as a Christian man, going to deal with this element of a very healthy ceremony? So what I did, at the advice of an older Native Christian leader, I said, we're not going to offer anything to the spirits or the Nahi, but we're going to honor the memory of the loss of the deceased. So I did just about everything that the traditionalists would do, but we did it in the memory of the deceased, not with the spirit of the deceased. So I believe there are many cultural forms that can be redeemed to glorify God, or that are just healthy. You know, I don't know that many people have a very good philosophy of grief. I think Indian people have a healthy way of dealing with grief. Our whole system, the social practices, I think are very healthy. I don't know if you want to tell a story about the brother or sister who did the puberty ceremony.
Let me get back to your finance question. Some of our denominations, Church of Nazarene, we need to work and we need some help with some economic development. The worldview that says we just need to raise up leaders and let you go, how our question in the Southwest was, how can we send a pastor to make $50 a month? And so we developed a Bible college, and I started new programs in human services. So there's a whole question of economic development and self-determination in that our ministers could make a decent living without abject poverty and meet the spiritual needs of our people. And so that's something that all of us need to look at and need to talk to our respective churches and leadership and denominations to say, hey, the power of the Spirit is awesome. But unless he's going to multiply my can of beans every day, you know what I'm saying? It doesn't happen every day, he multiplies that. And we sit down and we all, you know, some economic development needs to happen with our churches, with our leadership, with our district leadership. And we need a helping hand up into self-determination on a spiritual level, but also into that economic development where our leadership, our pastors, can make a living. And one lady at the Bible college, when I was there, she said when the missionaries told her that she couldn't weave baskets anymore because the what she would paint on the sign was evil. And so she quit. She believed the missionary. And I said, this is 20 years later. I said, well, how did you make a living back then? She goes, well, by making baskets. She was only one out of 10 people on her reservation that could weave a waterproof basket. And she's making baskets now, and that's the way she's supporting her ministry. Got in the Navajo reservation, they needed to paint. So they said, let's weave some rugs and sell them and put all that money to help our church. So there are things that maybe within our culture that we can use and develop ourselves to become self-supportive and say, well, I don't have tithe, but here, Pastor, go find a way to sell what I can make for you to feed your, to help you in your ministry and make bills. But as far as the other question was, we have to start to think about these things and dissect them with other like-minded people. And what might be okay for you might not be okay for somebody in the Southwest, as far as this goes. So, you know, it might have to be a regional or a tribal deal, but we have to go back and understand, what was the intent of the memorial? What's the intent of the potlatch? What's the intent of this or that? And discuss it and talk about it and look at it and search the Word of God and pray over it. And then come to some sort of conclusion without fear. That's the number one factor from my perspective, is fear. We don't want fear. I don't want to be afraid of my culture anymore. I don't want to be afraid that I'm going to be seen over here with somebody who's not a Christian and then be condemned for it, that I lost my salvation or that I backslid. Those things are hard to do, but just get together with people and the leaders and look at these things with new eyes. And I wouldn't have a problem with the memorial. It's when we miss faith in something else or some other spirit, and it takes away from the power and the message of the cross. And because the cross is a once-for-all ceremony, I don't have to pay a medicine man. I don't have to give up anything. I don't have to, if I do something wrong, the spirits aren't going to get me known. We don't want to live in fear. And Christ has delivered us from the fear of death. He has not given us a spirit of fear. So we're to live in fullness, in freedom, and in faith. So we need to just look at those things again. And I could give you another great example, but I think we're close to being out of time.
Definition of syncretism. It's a very important issue. We're wrestling with it. Maybe we wrestle with it around the country. I would suggest that we make a distinction between forms and their functions and sound theology. For example, I would say my definition of syncretism is that it is any belief or practice that in any way tries to replace, augment, or add to what only Christ can do with the cross. Syncretism is an issue of allegiance, and it's an issue of a belief system. Syncretism says, if I take and burn some sage, and I go like this, that will purify. That's giving allegiance and a belief that sage or cedar literally does for me what only Christ accomplished at Calvary. But could I, because the Bible says, for example, in Revelation, that our prayers are like incense and they rise up and they fill the nostrils of the Lord, could I just light a piece of incense or a piece of whatever and go like this and pray and say, Jesus, thank you for what you've done for me. This smoke reminds me. It's symbolic of my prayers rising up to you. I don't attach meaning to it other than the symbolic. I put no faith whatsoever in that smoke. Or when I wear that eagle feather. God made the eagle. There's nothing inherently evil about an eagle or a seagull. They're both birds. They're both scavengers, basically. One scavenger bird is no more evil or holy than another. But for us in the northern plains, because the eagle could go higher than any other bird, they used to believe it was a sacred bird. So they would wear those eagle feathers. But now what if me as a believer, I said, man, I'll put a seagull feather right next to my eagle feather, and I'll wear them both. But when I do that, what it reminds me of, what it symbolizes for me, is Isaiah chapter 58, where it says, you shall mount up on his wings as an eagle, you shall run, and you shall not faint, you shall never grow weary, your strength will be renewed, etc., etc. That's what that eagle feather reminds me of. That's why I wear it, because it points me to the Word of God. Now, I'm not saying you should do that. I'm not saying you should do anything that I'm thinking about. So don't tell anybody that Richard Twiss said, wear eagle feathers or smudge. I never said anything. It's on the video. I didn't say to people to do those things. But I want to stir your minds up to think about. Now, Leonard Grayson, well, this brother here, this is a question, and we have to end work for them.
Sing right, then spirit, but if I do, then good's going to happen. Well, those are ceremonies, and I say Christ has done the once-for-all ceremony. I don't have to go to a medicine man. My medicine man is on the throne right in heaven. I don't have to pay money to be healed. I don't have to pierce myself because Jesus was pierced for me. I don't have to live in fear of being cursed, because Galatians 3:13 says Christ has what? Delivered us from the curse of the law. The best of the best couldn't fulfill the righteousness of God. And Nicodemus was told he must be born again. And he was the brightest, the smartest, the most spiritual, the most politically correct guy. But Jesus said, what you're doing isn't enough. And it's not about doing. It's about faith in Jesus Christ and what he has done. As far as the drum, that's something that has to be looked at corporately in your church, in your denomination, or even regional. I can take a knife and I can go kill a bunch of people, or I can put it in the hands of a heart surgeon and he can heal 300 people a year with how he uses it. So it's how things are used. Is there a mixture of faith? Is it used to summon? Or is it used to express my worship to God? Now, personally, I can express my worship to God with a drum. But my background isn't like yours, brother. Okay? So these things have to be taught. And it's awesome to talk about it. Get it out. I don't want people to say this for years. And the Lord is against things that mix our faith and mess it up. But he has created us with a brain to use it in our discernment. Okay? We have discernment, and we need to decide our region here. We believe, according because of our background, we cannot drum to the Lord. Now, maybe the next generation can, or the third generation can, but for us right now, we can't do it. Is that maybe? have to know our Bible. And I'm not going to be spoon-fed by somebody else and tell me what it means. There's a priesthood of believers that I believe, that I know you guys believe in. And we have a right to search the Word of God for ourselves under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We're no longer children in the faith. We're rising from our past. So the Word of God is central. And then also correct knowledge or right knowledge about your people, about your culture, about certain things. And then you can dialogue over those things and go to the Word and get those things out.
Amen. We need to end. And I want to end with a prayer. I want you all to stand with me. I want to honor our brother Bill Lee as we pray. President of the Union Native American Fellowship, I believe in delegated authority. I believe God places shepherds in our lives. Some of these issues could be divisive. Some are. So our intent is not to stir division or strife amongst the brethren. The Bible says that he who sows discord among the brethren, and that's one of the seven abominations that God essentially pukes people out of his mouth about. So I don't want to become chunks or anything. So I want to honor this brother as a man that God has given authority in the Native American Fellowship. And so anything that we have said to you today, that you have pastors and district people that you can take these things to, and so we in no way want to inadvertently challenge the tenets of the faith for the Native American Fellowship. Assemblies of God, and we say we honor you and esteem you. And with that, I'd like us to just pray. Heavenly Father, we desire to be all that you intend for us to be. And we know, God, that you have made us tribal peoples and languages and ceremonies and customs and all of that. Lord, we are so grateful that you have given us your Holy Spirit. That gives us wisdom and searches the deep things that are in your heart and reveals them to us. And so, Lord, we just lift up who we are as cultural people. And we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would give us counsel which is from on high, which is peaceable, it's pure, and it's easily entreated. And, Lord, we pray that your Spirit would give us wisdom and insight into the Word of God, that the Word of God becomes the document that declares our freedom, not the document that imprisons us, that limits us, that binds us in ways that you intend to set us free in. So Lord, we are totally dependent on you to help us in these days, as Lord, I believe you want to get in our boats. And we say to you today, Lord, corporately, yes, Lord. Let's just say it together. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We invite you, Lord Jesus, to get into our boats, Lord, and take us where you want to take us, and the power and the wisdom, the understanding that only can come from your throne room, Lord. And Lord, we will be obedient to all that you show us and all that you teach us. And I just right now bind the spirit of division that would perhaps try and enter our minds and enter our midst. Father, we just bind the spirit of confusion in Jesus' name because it's not of you. And Father, we thank you that your Holy Spirit is clean and it's bright. Lord, and it shows the way and it tears down strongholds. So Father, we just pray that our time would have been one of blessing and one of enlightenment and understanding. And Father, we just bind any attempt of the devil to cause this to be negative for any person here. And we pray that you seal the blood of Jesus Christ as we lay it at the cross of Christ this afternoon. And we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.
Amen. We're not done yet. We have one more session. One more session. get excited. Thank you, brothers. Boy, this is a very educating week. I